Friday the 13th, Part 7, The New Blood, begins with a young girl, Tina, who's running away from her drunken and abusive father.
Baby, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to!
Go away!
Her emotions are so strong that it causes some sort of telekinetic reaction. A Jedi power, if you will, tearing down the dock, trapping him underwater and killing him. All by accident, from a power she didn't know she had. Years later, as an adult, Tina revisits the dock out of guilt and wishes she could bring him back. Well, it just so happens that Jason Voorhees is under the lake after having been chopped up by the propeller of a boat at the end of Part 6. Even though his eyes opened before the credits rolled, I guess he's supposed to have been dead all that time, and after all these years, Tina's powers bring him back to life. Now that Jason's walking about again, he immediately gets back to business, hacking people up. But you won't see much of that, thanks to the MPAA. Luckily, you can see all the deleted gory bits on the Blu-ray extras. The image quality sucks, but it's better than nothing. Isn't it a shame to see Jason pick up a giant weed whacker, or whatever kind of power tool this is, and build up to an amazing kill, only to cut away and not show us anything? Here's what you missed. Then there's the sleeping bag kill, which is one of Jason's funniest kills ever. In the final edit, you only see him smack the body against the tree once. Just once. But if it wasn't for the MPAA, it would have been several hits. The worst cut of all was when Jason squishes a guy's head. You see nothing, but originally, there was this awesome special effect. Oh, man. The movie suffers from the same usual thing. You don't care about anything but Jason. As far as the other characters are concerned, there's Tina, who we already mentioned. Then there's, nobody else worth mentioning, except maybe this geeky girl who reminds me of the boy crazy Irma from Ninja Turtles.
Robin, did you see the way David just looked at me?
Let's get back to Jason then. He's played by Kane Hodder for the first time, the only guy who had the balls to play Jason more than once. Since Jason is a role that requires a lot of stunts, it always made sense to use actors who can do their own stunts. He gave Jason a little more personality, like he's fucking pissed off all the time. Also, it's the best looking Jason of the whole series. The way he looks in this movie is just like he's been through 7 movies. Part of the mask is broken off, his clothing is all ragged, and you can see parts of his bones underneath. I also like how you see him in water more often, reminding us that he's a creature of the lake. There's even a little tribute to Jaws. That right there has got to be the shot they used for the cover of the NES game. Come to think of it, when I first became aware of Jason, this must have been the current movie. This makes it the Jason of my generation. The last 15 minutes is fucking awesome. You just have to wait through a lot of bullshit to get there. What we get here is a battle between Jason and Tina, using her telekinetic powers. It's like Luke Skywalker against Darth Vader, or even better, as the director John Carl Beekler described it, it's Carrie versus the Terminator. It's one of the best sequences in the whole series, number 3 in my top 13 moments. Jason has really met his match this time. He gets all fucked up. For much of the fight, Jason goes unmasked, finally getting rid of the mask that he's been wearing since Part 3. They did such a great job with Jason's face that they're not afraid to show it. Spoiler alert, if you want to talk about the ending, it's pretty stupid. Tina's dad comes up out of nowhere and drags Jason down. The director hated it and said that Jason's dad was supposed to look like a zombie with full makeup and prosthetics, but the associate producer didn't like it, so instead it's just a normal looking guy. It would have still been a weird ending, but the zombie look would have definitely helped it. In conclusion, this is a great installment because it does something different, but it's mostly just the ending that makes it so worthwhile. It's uneven for sure, and after watching through a marathon of these movies, it can be tiresome. I do have to say, I like that the running time of all these movies is almost consistently uniform at an hour and a half. You know that they're never gonna go over 2 hours like most movies today. Well, we're almost there. 3 more movies to go.